afternoon, everybody. I'm Patricia Duff, and I'm very happy to welcome our mini call-in audience members and our terrific guest speaker to the Common Good. We've got an extremely fascinating and very timely guest, so we're going to get right to the conversation. As you know, yesterday the House Judiciary Committee held an electrifying hearing with Attorney General Bill Barr as the lead witness, and of course, the Judiciary Committee has been extremely busy with many issues related to the rule of law, the Constitution, and some of the weightiest problems of our times, including the investigation related to the impeachment of the president earlier this year. I want to thank my dear friend and impressive businesswoman, Karen Mehiel, for co-hosting this event and helping to put it together. Thanks to her and her husband, Dennis Mehiel, today we are thrilled to welcome one of the leading members of Congress, a recent presidential candidate, an avid gun control advocate, author of a brand new book, and an impressive member of the Judiciary Committee who had quite a moment of his own during the hearing yesterday. I saw you trending on Twitter. And to help us out, we are extremely honored to have with us, to moderate the conversation, a longtime true civic and business leader, Dennis Mehiel, who has an incredible history of running both major businesses and huge government programs and agencies, as well as launching political and philanthropic initiatives. So Dennis, the timing of this event with Congressman Swalwell is extraordinary today. Thank you both so much for being with the Common Good this afternoon. And now I pass the baton to Dennis to lead our conversation.
Thank you, Patricia. And I think you're all blessed by not being able to see me.
So let's, I don't know.
I'll be on audio. Eric, we planned this to talk a little bit about your book and particularly your experience through the impeachment process. So I don't want to let the Barr testimony extinguish, you know, soak up all the time. But certainly, as Patricia said, it's quite timely. So let me give you my my first question, and it does relate to yesterday's testimony, and let me say that I was singularly impressed with your questioning, and you showed yourself off to be an ex-prosecutor. Let me put it that way, and you had this guy in the dock, okay? But here's my question. I just want you to share with us your impressions and your reactions to what you heard yesterday. And do you believe the Attorney General perjured himself during that testimony, or did he successfully tap dance around it?
There was a lot of tap dancing, Dennis, and thank you, Dennis, Karen, as well as Patricia and the Common Good for hosting this. I've been excited to talk about the book, and you know, yesterday would have been another chapter if I had not dropped the curtain on the book. And the theme of the hearing yesterday, as we prepared for it, was that under our democracy, there seems to be, you know, two sets of rules, one for the president and his friends, and then one for the rest of us. But that can really only be true if the Attorney General enables it. And what we wanted to point out, that whether it was the special treatment that Roger Stone and Michael Flynn have received, or the Attorney General signing off on the president's fraudulent claims around mail-in balloting, or the Attorney General taking, you know, to task, or deploying police officers to cities across the country where there are Black Lives Matter protests, but not deploying them where people are showing up with camo gear and AR-15s, storming state houses and threatening to kill Democratic governors. He's not deploying them there. That, you know, he is selectively choosing how to use our police, and it's all in service to the president. It was interesting that he knows the old trick where if you don't want to answer the question, you say, I don't recall. And what the first question I had for him was, other than Roger Stone, the president's longtime friend and advisor, have you ever intervened in a case to reduce someone's sentence? And he started with, I don't recall. And I know that on something that big, any attorney general would recall. And then that was my next question. Well, how would you not recall something like that? And we were able to pin him down to say no. He never had before. On the issue of Michael Cohen, that will be interesting on whether he perjured himself or not. So just to kind of set the table on that, you know, Michael Cohen, like many people, was released early for COVID, but had put in front of him a contract by the Bureau of Prison that said he could only stay out of custody if he agreed not to write a book or post anything on social media. which to me as a prosecutor seems okay if you're going to do that for everyone. It is a gag order in many ways, but if he couldn't do it in prison, then I understand if he's getting special treatment to be let out, maybe that's okay. But a federal judge found that in his 21 years, he's never seen this rule applied to anyone. That's not even a rule, and it's only been applied to Cohen, and he called it retaliatory. And so whether the attorney general knew that or not, had advanced knowledge that he'd be asked of that, is interesting, because it is under the Department of Justice that he runs, and it seems in line with how the president operates.
Well, you answered part of my second question, but that's helpful and insightful. So I can infer from some of your comments just now, you agree that the use of federal personnel in Portland and other cities that I guess are threatened, maybe I don't know if any have gone to Chicago or Seattle yet, but basically this is politically driven activity designed to provoke the reaction on the streets that he's looking for to justify his actions in the first place. So we're at a place now, and this, I'm talking not only about the president, but the attorney general, both of them.
Dennis, the speaker nicknamed Donald Trump earlier this week. She said he's Mr. Make Things Worse. And the concern is that, well, first, anyone who tries to burn a building or torch a car, you know, or commits anarchy, yes, we want them to be held accountable. But they weren't experiencing the problems that they're experiencing now because of the provocative acts of going into these cities with camo gear and unidentified officers doing what the Department of Homeland Security Secretary said are proactive arrests. And that's just not what we do in this country. You can't arrest somebody without probable cause. And so I would rather see them work with local law enforcement and, you know, protect against any crimes, but allow the peaceful assembly of people. And certainly if you're gassing a wall of moms or shooting projectiles at unarmed individuals or veterans, you've gone too far, and we need to rein it in.
But it does seem clear that the entire activity is part of the Trump re-election campaign and wants to drive that particular narrative. The irony on this, and then we'll get to you and your book, is that where we do have an increase year over year in violence in some of these cities, which is true statistically, the violence is not in the demonstrations that he's sending the troops to. It's in some of the neighborhoods and some of the difficulties that we have in some of our urban centers. But it doesn't come from, and I don't know why this isn't obvious to every person in the country, but you know, I guess we all see things through our own prisms and experience. Let me move on beyond Barr. First of all, where in the world did you get the time to write the book? When did you start? Because, you know, it's predominantly about, but there's a lot of your history in there and how you got in politics and some of your experiences. Did you already have half the book written and then the impeachment came along, or did you decide and you jammed it all into a few weeks? How did that work?
I had written a lot about my father, who was a police chief in a small town in Iowa where I was born. And I always wanted to write a tribute to him, because my earliest memory was my father standing up against corruption in a small town and losing his job because of it. And we had to move the family out west. And my earliest memory was that he did not bend when he was asked to look the other way on cases involving the mayor. And the mayor and the council who was in on it with the mayor fired him. And so I was able to find Des Moines Register stories about my father. I thought that was a nice way to kind of have a parallel story of a person in a small town who stood up to a corrupt mayor with his son, who would be the first in the family to go to college, 34 years later, who would be on the Judiciary and Intelligence Committee. So that part had already at least been researched. But I did want to write something that was a tribute to the people like Masha Yovanovitch and Fiona Hill and Lieutenant Colonel Vindman, who came forward, because I believe that what we found was that courage begetted courage, and that if we could shine a light on those who came forward, even now by writing a book, it could telegraph to others that if you see corruption, we still need you to come forward. I wrote the book with the cooperation of a one-year-old daughter who every night when I would put her down, instead of reading her a bedtime story or a song or singing a song, I would dictate to her in a sing-song voice what had happened that day, and would record it and then have it transcribed so that I could write about it. So some people may call that child abuse, but if you listen to the audio, I think you could adapt it to be a children's story, a very cruel, dark children's story, but a children's story.
Well, in the real world today, particularly in your job, you have to be able to do two things at the same time. So
that's right. And I hear a bunch of little monsters have just come in the house. So I will balance this interview with a three-year-old and a one-year-old.
That's good. That's good. I think it's fair to say in this alternate universe we're living in that impeachment, at this point, the impeachment trial, if you will, or the hearings that led up to in the trial, it's ancient history. It's been, you know, a few months, but it seems like in another complete era. Given the unrelenting velocity of events and so on, what and all that's happened since, what stays with you from your experience through the investigation by the committees that ultimately led to the impeachment, and then of course the trial itself? What's your takeaway, and what stayed with you on that?
Yeah, keep checking the president because it works. But you're right, impeachment feels like it was 10 exits ago. But the pattern of conduct continues. You know, as we went into the pandemic, the same conduct that the president was impeached for, putting his own personal interests above the country's, is exactly how he conducted himself in the early days, especially with your great city, where he would tell governors and mayors that they could get ventilators and personal protective equipment if they said nice things about him. So again, this was an example that was used in our impeachment inquiry. We never imagined that this crisis would come, but we said, what if a governor or the president leveraged resources in a natural disaster or a crisis if people, you know, would do things politically for him? And that's what the president exactly did. And so we continue to see this. We see this now with the allegations around Russia paying for bounties on the lives of our troops, and the president not standing up to Putin, again, putting his own interests ahead of the country's. But the lesson I took away, Dennis, in impeachment, aside from believing that there was evidence to impeach him, that if we didn't impeach him, the standard of conduct would be lower for future presidents, but that once we did impeach him and start the investigation, Ukraine got the aid. And so although he was not removed, the right result occurred because they had not received the aid only until they only received it once we started that investigation.
Yeah. You know, this whole trial, all of the evidence that was presented, all of the testimony we saw from some of those folks that you mentioned, didn't lower his ratings and polling an iota. Now, the COVID seems, you know, his unfavorables have risen, you know, and so on since the COVID hit. How do you interpret that? Why is it that after 3 years, because the impeachment to some degree was a little bit of a culmination, if you will, but we had been watching this from the day the guy was inaugurated, and his numbers, although not that great, never changed. Finally, the COVID showed up, and he's really taken a beating in terms of public opinion. How do you interpret that? Why didn't all of this egregious behavior make any difference, and now all of a sudden it does?
And you're right. What we were impeaching him for involved a country thousands of miles away, and you know, we were trying to prevent the rigging of an upcoming election. And so I think the American people understood it, because most polls show overwhelming, or over 50%, a majority of the country supported it. But you're right, his approval rating kind of tracked the same. I think the reason that it has dipped as low as it has is because this is what we elected him for. You don't elect presidents to preside over the good times. You elect them for what they would do during the hard times. And he has utterly failed. And I believe that is why he ultimately is going to lose. But one other point, Dennis, we were focused on the conduct of the president, but you couldn't ignore that what he was trying to do was have a foreign country tarnish and dig up dirt and falsify claims against who he perceived his political opponent was going to be. Well, that person, the president, knew what he was doing. That person was Joe Biden. He survived the primaries. But I believe we have inoculated Joe Biden against these spurious attacks. So while the president's approval rating did not go down, he was not successful in using false claims against Biden to take down Biden as the Russians were able to do in 2016 with Secretary Clinton. So I do think that while that was not our aim, that is also an end result that you can't ignore.
Yeah. How do you and your colleagues see the landscape this year? I understand that, 90 days is an eon in politics. We get that. But there's a lot of what I would characterize as momentum that I feel building up. I would also say that our presidential candidate on the Democratic side may be the luckiest candidate in the history of the world. Now, it took a terrible pandemic that is horrendous to create that circumstance, but he can sit around in his basement, make an occasional video, and allow his opponent to immolate himself on a daily basis. But that's where I sit as a very frankly, a hyper-partisan and typically an over-optimistic person about our chances, because I tend to be wrong more than I'm right. But how do you and your colleagues see, what's your sense of the outcome in the House, the Senate? And obviously we think that Joe can beat Trump, but what's the sense up on the Hill? Are we in a wave? Are we back to 1932? I mean, where are we?
So we have every reason to be confident. In fact, I would rather be us than them. Sorry, now I have a dog, children and a dog. We have every reason to be confident, Dennis. And I think there's a tendency among Democrats to fight the last war. And this is not 2016. In fact, Donald Trump is the incumbent. He used Hillary Clinton as a foil with the help of the Russians, to amplify stories against her and the hacking and leaking campaign that was run. But that isn't the case this time. And by the way, as I said, we have a pandemic and the worst economy since the Great Depression. So all of his failures in leadership have been exposed. And so I tell my colleagues all the time, I get it. We can't take it for granted. We won't. But confidence also inspires confidence. So let's carry ourselves with the confidence that not only can Joe Biden win, but we can win and add to the House and win the Senate. I really believe we can have that holy trinity. So I'm excited for what's ahead. I do believe that Speaker Pelosi is going to have a very, very challenging first 100 days, in the Congress, putting together what would not normally be a president's first 100 days initiatives, but rather fulfilling the Heroes Act, which we've already passed, but the Senate will not take up, to address the true COVID recovery and relief. But I'm very optimistic about what we can do.
That's good. Patricia, how much more time do I have before we go to questions?
You've got 10 minutes.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
I'm a political junkie, so I kind of stay with the politics. Eric, if we think about January of 2021, and if we're successful, as we hope that we will be, and as we just discussed, we understand, obviously, getting muscle behind our capacity to deal with this pandemic, which is likely to still be here at that time, certainly is going to be front and center. We understand that. We know the overall economic activity, the contraction of our economy, the millions of people out. So we understand those two major issues. And then, of course, we have all of the social unrest that's been unleashed by this horrendous video we all had to sit through when George Floyd was murdered out in Minneapolis. So those are going to be things that are going to be coming out of new administration and your Congress as you convene. But just drawing back a little bit, and if we thought about the first year and a half, the first 2 years of a new administration, where do you see, what do you believe should be the primary objective? We get past those immediate challenges or we engage those, I get that. But what should our vision be for where we want to take the country, and what are the critical activities that need to be undertaken to bring that vision to fruition?
unite the country first. That has to be the goal. Thankfully, that's Joe Biden's default. You know, he in the Senate instinctually would want to work with Republicans. When he was vice president, anytime we had, you know, a budget disagreement, he was dispatched to the Capitol to strike the deal. And I believe that never Trumpers are going to need a home. And the worst thing we could do would be to have the White House, the Senate, and the House, and just treat Republicans the way we've perceived that they've treated us. I actually think there's going to be a lot of them, never Trumpers, whether it's people he could put in the cabinet or people, you know, in Congress who may be liberated from Donald Trump, that we could work with. And really, as I said, put reforms in place so that no president could ever come in and expose, you know, what's happened in the way that we did after Watergate, you know, post-Watergate reforms. But also, as you pointed out, in addition to the COVID relief, there's also going to have to be, I believe, long-term, long-standing solutions on healthcare. And Joe Biden, someone who led the Cancer Moonshot Initiative, understands that, you know, healthcare is, yes, a large part insurance. And I think he's going to be able to find that common ground on a public option rather than, you know, a single payer system. But I believe what he can really lead on is investing in cures and investing in the idea that if we have genetic research, if we have targeted therapies, if, you know, we know what we are predisposed to, that we can treat it a lot earlier and have better preventive measures in our country. That is something he has long been wanting to do. And I think that's a uniting idea in our country. And then Dennis, you know, addressing the income inequality in our country, which has only been worsened by COVID. And as many have told me, if you were on the edge, you've probably gone over the cliff since COVID. But otherwise, you know, the stock market for those who were doing really well continues to do well. And, you know, we're going to have to reconcile that. And so I think a country that is more racially just, more, you know, opportunities for people who have not realized it before. But again, just getting our friends back. I don't know about you guys, but I've lost a lot of friends during the Trump administration. I'm a son of two Republicans. I married a Hoosier from Southern Indiana. I go on Fox News so my family can see me. But this president has been so toxic and divisive that I would really like to see the president lead and bring people back together and make Thanksgiving a little more enjoyable in 2021.
It kind of leads into another question, which maybe will be my last, but first, where in Southern Indiana?
Columbus. So my wife grew up with the Pence family, believe it or not. And so when I go home, the airport ride from Indianapolis to Columbus, which is about 50 minutes, I get about a full Sean Hannity experience with my father-in-law. And so it actually, and I love him, but it gives me an opportunity, I think, to understand how, you know, other people who support the president or people like my mother-in-law, who's going to vote for Joe Biden, it'll be the first Democrat in her life, why they have left the president or the Republican Party. And I think we need to still, you know, be open-minded to have conversations with each other. My father-in-law told me something revealing. He's going to vote for Donald Trump, but he does not have the same, and this is, I think, frankly, just a male chauvinistic view, but he doesn't have the same distrust of Biden that he has of Hillary. And he said to me, you know, Eric, if Biden winning is what it takes for this country not to be so divided, then I guess I'll be okay with that. And I think that was his way of saying it's not going to be the end of the world for him. And so I hope we can find a way to heal the country.
Yeah, you go another hour and 20 minutes south, you get to Bedford, where I went to grade school, middle school, but I never got high school. We moved up to Lawrence, Indiana. All right, brings me to my last question, and you just led into it again. Let's go to the racial unrest, right, which we've all observed the manifestations of that recently. How do we bring peace to our society, really? In other words, we can talk about it, we can take down statues, you know, we can have rhetoric. How do we get on a path that takes us to true reconciliation, in your view? If you're the president, if you're leading the country, how would you try to drive that process?
Yeah, I really think, Dennis, we all have to be honest with ourselves about our country's original sin. And being honest about that, you know, doesn't mean that, you know, we have to, you know, accuse people of being, you know, racist, but it means that we need to be aware that we haven't been honest about it. And we haven't recognized that for generations in America that Black Americans, particularly Black males, have been really dehumanized. And I saw this when I ran for president, going to America's best cities, Chicago, Baltimore, Philadelphia, Houston, the best cities that have high rates of gun violence. And to talk to the families there and to hear the stories and to just see, you know, that immediately as a young Black man, you know, what you're subjected to and the confidence issues that you have because of the way that you're talked about culturally or treated, you know, in education and in business and in society. And we really have to reconcile that. And we have to understand what it means for a young Black person to interact with the police. And for me, Dennis, I'll tell you, as the son of a police officer and two brothers who are police officers in Oakland, I've seen the best of police, but I've also seen too many situations as a former prosecutor where people were treated differently because of the color of their skin. And so a couple weeks ago, I went home to a church in my district and brought the community to get together, a couple community leaders, and we talked about what it was going to take to change the landscape in our country around racial issues. And one community leader said to me, he said, you know, Eric, I feel safe twice a day. When I wake up in my own bed and when I walk through my own door after work. In between, I drive a nice car that I worked hard for. And in my neighborhood, I see people looking at me. They judge me. They assume I'm a drug dealer. I've done something wrong to get the car. He said, more than two or three times a week, people follow me while I'm driving. Police officers follow me while I'm driving. And I know they're running my plates to see if I have a warrant. And I don't, and I go on with my business. And this individual is a police captain in the largest police force in my district. And I've tried to tell other officers that if a Black police captain only feels safe when he's home, imagine how Black Americans who are not law enforcement feel. And so I really think it's having those hard conversations that Vice President Biden has the credibility to lead on. And with, I believe, will probably be, and I hope, as a person of color, as his vice president, will also be able to reach out to Americans to lead on.
All right, well, before I let Patricia knock me off here, and we go to questions.
You're getting knocked off pretty soon.
I can see that expression. I see you moving around, you're getting ready.
No, we've got a few people waiting too.
Yeah, we'll move to that right now. But let me just say, Eric, and we didn't talk that much about your book. You know, if we were doing this at the apartment, we'd have the book stacked up, you'd have them all signed, you know, and that type of thing. So hopefully everybody ran out and bought a copy before we had this meeting.
And Dennis, I'm going to put in the chat box here my email, and I will send a book plate, a signed book plate to anyone who would like it. But thank you again for talking about the book.
But what a great idea.
One of the things the book does, it just gives us insight and a view to one of many, many, many American stories that you just articulated a little bit here today. But it's the path of your life so far that gives me such great confidence in the ultimate United States of America and where we're going to go and the kind of country that we are and but that we're going to be. We're just proud of you for that, and we congratulate you and the work that and the emotion and your character and who you are that went into that writing. So I just wanted to make that point, and I'll turn it over to our boss, Patricia.
Okay, you're the boss today, but hopefully I'm going to help move this along a little bit since we could lose the congressman at any chance. First of all, I want to thank you, Dennis, for doing such a great job there. And thank you, Congressman, for your words of reconciliation. I loved your comment, courage begets courage. I think that's certainly true. And we have a lot of people online who are activists who I think have been shown courage in their own way. And I would have a lot of questions about, you know, whether the president can stay in office after election and how are we going to handle voting in the fall. And what your opinion is, I just want to ask you this one thing, which is a little bit, What is your opinion of the violence? There is some violence by protesters in the demonstrations. I was reading today something about what some of the young people were doing in Portland. Some of them aren't so young. Joe Biden has addressed this. I'm just wondering about your thoughts, and then we're going to get to the many questions here.
It's wrong, and it should be stopped where it occurs. But, you know, again, as someone who has brothers in local law enforcement, I trust their ability to do it. And if they're not doing it right, work with them constructively so they can. But again, I think it takes leadership at the very top. If you have a president who is calling out, who is standing with peaceful protesters and condemning violence, I think the country tends to follow. And right now we don't have that. And as I said, it's just making matters worse.
Right. And we just lost a great leader who understood that, you know, when you protest, you're best if you keep the moral high ground. But we have a number of people who want to ask you questions. Let's start with Francis Milberg.
Hi. I had read in a Twitter that Jay Johnson identified the fact that subcontractors were being used. And I heard that FHS, I don't even know what it stands for, works with subcontractors, and that these subcontractors were hired through Eric Prince. And he's a famous guy of both Blackwater infamy, and he's also the brother of Elizabeth DeVos. So that would explain these people haven't been trained, and Blackwater people, my word, were killers. Have you or anybody else on the committee learned anything about this?
We're trying to find out. Thank you for the question. We are voting actually today and tomorrow on Homeland Security funding, and a lot of the legislation that we're putting forward would restrict their ability to use, you know, private security forces, would require transparency, you know, to Congress, and the public would require, you know, uniforms to identify what agency anyone in a situation like this is from. But right now, this is a big part of the problem. We just don't know because they're not being forthcoming about whether they are using contractors or not. I would say it would be wrong to use contractors. I think the camo gear and the militarization look is not helping things. But even worse, if it's contractors who have not sworn an oath and affiliated with Eric Prince, who I interviewed in the Russia investigation, that would be very, very bad.
Okay, Bob Wyman, your question, please.
Yeah, sorry, unmuting there. Listen, so much of what we have to do is in the international world, and it's important how other countries and other people respond to us. And I was looking at a Gallup poll the other day, a new poll is out, and it says that, you know, today, Germany is the number one respected national government in the world. The United States is far below in the rankings. And that's the sort of thing, you know, one can just sort of blow off as its opinion, but it's the sort of thing that's going to have massive impact on our country, I think, in the future. Can you talk to us about what the process is for us to essentially rebuild our international status? And you know, I know getting rid of Trump is probably a big part of that, but beyond that one first step, how do we go about reestablishing ourselves as America, you know, as the dream that this country is supposed to be, and get up and compete a little bit with the Germans in terms of international reputation? Because it's not about the competition, it's about the results. How do we do that? What do we have to accomplish? How do we go?
Thank you for that. Germany's number one because it's a country that's run by a woman, I think, first and foremost. But what we can do is have President Biden, and also, you know, our Secretary of State, go on a global redemption tour to repair the alliances that the president has frayed. And these are some of our closest allies who have been insulted, like Canada, Australia, the French, obviously Germany. But I also believe that the biggest issue that has the most unity in the world is around addressing climate chaos. And I believe President Biden should host in the United States a Paris 2.0 summit I would do it in a, you know, Midwestern city, an industrial city, and talk about how we can address climate and also see it as a way not to see as investments in climate as a way to actually stimulate the economy as we come out of COVID. I think that would show tremendous leadership. And when it comes to China, which, you know, remains not just a persistent national security threat, but a, you know, a threat to trade and our economic interests, the best way to take them on, I believe, is through a class action, you know, align with other countries who are victims of currency manipulation, steel dumping, intellectual property theft, and economic espionage, and work with them to take on China. But right now, you know, our standing in the world has been reduced. There's only 20 countries who will allow a U.S. passport today, and most of those countries require a health security deposit when you arrive. And so there's going to be a lot of damage that's going to have to be repaired. But I think President Biden, with a unity team, not just of Democrats, but I think also of bringing in Republicans into the cabinet, could do a lot of work to restore and advance our status.
Interesting. Reuben Kram, do you have a question?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Patricia. Congressman, thank you for your presentation. And I am, I admire the confidence and the, and I agree with you that being confident is an important first step. But many of us fear that even if there is a result, even if he gets an unfavorable result, the president in the election, the president will not step down, or will not accept the outcome of the election. And one of the things that the attorney general said yesterday was that he would, as I believe he put it, he would do it. He would recognize it if it was clear. I'm wondering what is Congress doing and what will Congress do to ensure, first of all, the integrity of the election, and to somehow prepare for or protect against the possibility that, notwithstanding an outcome that is favorable to Vice President Biden, there could be a resistance to turn over the office.
Ruben, this is the question I am asked most often on this book tour, and it's painful that that is a question everywhere in America that's being asked, because we've always enjoyed the peaceful transfer of power in our country.
It is indeed.
What is Congress doing? Well, today, this morning, the Intelligence Committee, we voted to allow members of Congress to see an updated foreign interference threat to our country that we were just briefed on only for the intelligence community, but we wanted the whole Congress to see it because it involves Congress. And so just awareness as it relates to what the threats could be, you know, at the ballot box, I think is really important. And while it's classified right now, we do believe at least making our colleagues aware so that we can act as necessary is important and was not done in 2016. Your question, I think, is certainly around, you know, the ballot box and access to the polls. And so I think beneath the surface, we have to be in the courts and at the registrar of voters, the registrars of voters' offices, making sure that the rolls are not purged and people have access. But above the surface, as far as like what we say in campaign ads or what our candidates or people like myself who would be interviewed say in television interviews, we really need to focus, I think, on healthcare, healthcare, healthcare. That's what won us the midterms. That's what's going to motivate people to turn out again right now, this election. And if we talk about voter suppression, that actually has the effect of suppressing the vote. And I think, you know, these governors who are reducing access to the polls or not allowing mail-in balloting would love if all we did was complain about that all the way to the election day. Because if you think about it, that single mom in a swing state like Arizona or Georgia, who's budgeted 1 hour to vote on election day and has to pick up her little girl, get her fed, get her bathed, get her to bed, and has 1 hour to vote, if all she hears the Democrats talking about is that the election is going to be rigged or you may have to stand in a long line, she may not show up. And so the problem we want to have is to overwhelm the ballot box so the result cannot be denied, and then immediately in the new majority, make the changes so that we don't have to, you know, see this problem every year. What would we do if he didn't leave office? Well, I think, and this is something I posited in the book, that Donald Trump is a coward. And if you check him, he will back down. And if the vote is so overwhelming, I think he's going to leave and he's not going to challenge it. My fear though, is if it's close, that's where he could thrive. That's where foreign interferers could amplify false stories around mail-in balloting. That's where he could intimate that, you know, these armed militia persons who've gone to the other state capitals with their assault rifles should come and protect him. That's where the chaos could really happen. And so as my coach in college told me at halftime, anytime I was complaining about the ref, he would always say to me and my teammates, well, don't make it close. And I know that's not fair because a majority should win, but we can't make it close. And I think that's how you get the surest exit of Donald Trump.
Well, we've got a lot of questions about the election. But next, Jill Lafer, are you available?
Hi, Congressman. First of all, thank you for your time today.
Thank you. Thanks, Jill.
So after hearing Barr's response yesterday, I will follow the law. I'm wondering, what are the...
Oh, dear.
Scenarios that could play out on ballots and with everything that they're doing to hold up the take down the post office. What are the possible scenarios and how would they play out? And if this went to a vote in the House because it went to the court and went to shutting down ballot counting or whatever. Take us down that road for a minute or two. Did we lose him?
Congressman, were you able to hear the question? Yeah.
Yes, I heard the question. And what I see the Attorney General being able to do, and this is my fear, is that he would be able to use the power and authority of the office to file lawsuits on behalf of the president. And that's what we wanted to make sure he would not do we wanted to know that he would not involve the Department of Justice in any litigation that the president would file. So that's a big fear right now, is that he would do that. And so we want a pledge from him that he won't. We also don't want him to file lawsuits against states who implement mail-in balloting because of fears around COVID. And that, again, is a fear that we have right now. That he would do. So we're trying to, again, just as the president is trying to seed that the election result is going to be fraudulent, we're trying to inoculate against that and try and show who they really are by making the public aware that this is what they're going to do and really putting the Attorney General on his heels to try and hopefully deter him from doing it.
Okay, we're going to move quickly. Sorry, Jonathan Barnett.
Congressman, I want to compliment you on something you did and ask how you did it, because it's truly remarkable. Yesterday, ostensibly in a hearing, they're supposed to have an official report to Congress. He paid to one person. He was willing to lie to your face. He was absolutely abdicating his responsibility and betraying his oath of office, the Constitution, and the United States. How do you keep your patience and decency in the face of that?
Thank you for that question. So when I was a prosecutor, I learned very early on during closing argument, as I would listen to a defense attorney just mischaracterize the evidence or personally attack me, I would jump out of my chair and I would object. And a more senior prosecutor told me, you may be right on every objection you made and the judge may have ruled with you every time, but pretty soon the jury can't tell the difference between you and the defense attorney because you're both just going back and forth at it. And sometimes you just need to not respond to everything they do or to respond dispassionately and not
let it seem like it's something you're taking too personally. And so in some things you should be taking personally, but I've tried to, you know, not allow them to throw me off my game, because I learned the hard way trying cases, you know, early on in my career. So I'm not perfect, by the way. Thank you for saying that. I have certainly lost my cool, and some things are worth losing your cool about, I guess. But with the Attorney General, you know, we prepared for about a month for him to come in, and I watched a lot of his testimony, and I actually thought Kamala Harris had handled him best in prior testimony to Congress. And so I really watched what she had done with him, and she kept him on his heels. Every time he tried, she didn't talk over him and take away his time or not let him finish. But every time he tried to say, I don't know, or, well, you know, something like he would try and obfuscate, she kept really needling him on what exactly he meant. And I thought that was the best way to go at him. And so, I guess just try and keep your cool and realize that you want the jury or the American people to be able to tell the difference between you and the person that you're interviewing.
Well, thank you so much. I'm so sorry we're out of time. I can't believe we got to see you on the way with your good trouble mask on, getting ready to vote. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure meeting you so many months ago, and equally a pleasure today. Dennis, and you did such a tremendous job. We can tell what a great political person you are. Karen, thank you. And you must buy his book. It's going to be fascinating, and he'll send you the little library thing, so with his signature on it. So I hope you will buy it. And thank you again, Congressman. I hope we have you back.
Thank you again, Patricia, Karen, Dennis, and everyone who joined. Thank you for what you're doing to bring people together and have conversations. And these conversations are going to be ever more important as our country starts to heal, but also, you know, to build a better country, because I still think it's one worth redeeming. So thank you all, and be well.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you.
Think about shaving.
So next week, I hope you'll come back. We've got we're going to be talking about the economy next week. We had a question about the economy and anxiety about that. I'm sorry we didn't get to you, Rhea. And a lot of other questions we didn't get to this time. And then during the convention weeks, each week we will have a panel about the conventions at the end of the week. So I think those will be really interesting. Then in September, we'll start talking about foreign affairs with Jane Harman, the former Homeland Security Chief Michael Chertoff, and our Jay Johnson, our Homeland Security Secretary and board member, with retired Colonel Chris Kalenda on Afghanistan and negotiating with the Taliban. It'll all be very interesting. So join us next week. And thank you so much. Thank you, Karen. Thank you, Dennis. Appreciate it so much. You guys were fabulous. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.